Well, I want to talk a little bit about Noah's flood in the few minutes that we have. We talked a little bit this morning about when and how was all of that formed. How did those rock layers that we see in the Grand Canyon, but those same layers are on every continent, not the exact same layers, but the same kinds of layers. And so the whole Earth is covered with a massive graveyard of rock layers and fossils. And the evolutionists say that it took 300 million years to deposit those layers, and 1 to 5 or maybe up to 70 million years, depending on which geologist you're talking to carve the Grand Canyon. And in those layers, there are fossils, and there are more layers on top of those layers as you go north and east into Utah and Colorado and Wyoming. And so the evolutionists say that from the first living cell up to the present is about 3.5 billion years. And most Christians in the 27 countries I've spoken in, most Christians accept those millions of years. They haven't really thought about the issue, but they just accept them. Most Christian college and seminary professors accept those millions of years and haven't really thought about it, but just think it doesn't really matter. But most of them, I've also found, have never thought very carefully about Noah's flood. But Noah's flood is critical to the age of the earth. And there have been four views of Noah's flood in earth history, in church history. For 18 centuries, the almost universal belief is what many believe today also, that the flood was a historical global catastrophe. 200 years ago is when the idea of millions of years was developed in geology by unbelieving non-Christian geologists using those naturalistic assumptions. And so some Christians said, well, it was a historical flood, but it was just a big flood in the Middle East, in the modern area of Iraq and Iran. And then some said, well, it was a historical flood, but it was just a global peaceful flood. It left no geological evidence, no erosion, no sedimentation. And then there were others who are theologically liberal, who say, well, Genesis is a myth. There never was an Adam and Eve. There never was a flood. That's just a story. So I want to just share a few things from the Bible and geology to support the global flood. One is the purpose of the flood. A lot of people think that God sent the flood to destroy sinful man, but that is not what the Bible says. The Bible says that God sent the flood to destroy sinful man and all the land animals, all the birds, not in the ark, and the surface of the earth. And only a global flood will accomplish that purpose, because a local flood in the Middle East is not going to kill any animals or birds in North America, South America, Europe, Africa, Asia, Russia, Australia. Only a global flood will do that. The purpose of the ark. God told Noah to build an ark, not to save some animals, to start a farm after the flood, but to save two of every kind of unclean animal and bird on the land, and seven pairs of the clean animals and birds, to keep offspring alive on the face of all the earth. And the ark was totally unnecessary if it was a local flood in the Middle East. And didn't need to put the animals in there, and he could have just told Noah and his family to go on a vacation to Europe. So no need for the ark, unless it was a global flood. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. And when people walk onto our ark, we've even had non-Christian journalists come onto the ark when it was being built and kind of scoffing at it. And once they got inside the ark, they said, wow, I can see how you could fit a lot of animals in here. Well, we've had scientists calculate how many animals had to go in the ark. They were kinds, not species. And so it was only a little less than 7,000 animals, average size about the size of a large sheep. And so I encourage you to come. I don't know why I have duplicate slides there. Then there's the character of the flood. It was designed to destroy all the land animals, birds, and people not in the ark and the surface of the earth, so that would be violent. I think I talked about, I can't remember whether I talked about it earlier. I'm kind of, my days are all blending together. But there were two sources for the water, the fountains of the great deep, which is subterranean water coming into the oceans under high pressure and temperature, and the floodgates of the sky, pouring rain, Hurricane Michael rain. So you would have massive mudslides causing destruction, and you would have earthquakes and volcanoes causing tsunamis on the ocean floor that would cause incredible damage, as that one in Japan did. And anything not in the ark would die, and many of those creatures would be ripped apart, and their bodies or bones would be buried in rock layers to become fossils. And then the depth of the flood. The Bible's very clear that all the high mountains under the heavens were covered. And if you covered the mountains that are west of here on the other side of, what is that island or peninsula west of West Seattle?
Olympic
Peninsula. If you covered those mountains with water and covered Mount Rainier with water, you would cover the whole United States except for maybe a few mountain peaks in the Rockies and Mount McKinley. And you would flood New York and London and Tokyo and Cape Town, South Africa. You would have a global flood. And so Christians who believe in a local flood have to believe in something like that. But that's not a photograph. That's six photographs. Some of them turned on their sides by one of our clever artists. That was not Noah's flood. That's illogical, and it is contrary to what the Bible actually says. And then the rainbow promise at the end, God said he would never again send a flood, and that promise is only true if it was a global flood. If it was a local flood, then God lied, because there have been many local floods that have killed some people, some animals, and destroyed some of the earth. And what would we expect to find from that flood? We'd expect to find billions of dead things buried in rock layers that were once soft sediments deposited by water, sand, silt, clay, mud. We'd expect to find evidence that those layers were deposited by water and not wind-blown in a desert, and we'd expect to find the evidence all over the earth. And that's exactly what we find. Billions of dead things buried in rock layers laid down by water all over the earth. Now, the fossils do not come with labels on them saying how old they are. And they don't date the fossils by the dating methods. They don't date the layers that the fossils are in by the dating methods. We'll talk about those methods in a moment. But the fossils themselves speak of rapid burial, rapid fossilization, and that means that the layers they in were formed rapidly and hardened to rock rapidly. So the ichthyosaur caught in the act of giving birth, the fish that didn't get to finish swallowing lunch. Did I show you these before? Well, it's worth just thinking about it. Two turtles mating, and they get buried. And this bug and this worm and this manure had to be fossilized, had to be turned to stone quickly, or they wouldn't be that way. We have cows living on fields, and they drop their cow pies, and their cow pies do not stay in perfect condition for decades or even years. Here's some more evidence that the rock layers were laid down. Now, the fossils speak of that they were laid down rapidly and turned to stone rapidly. But if you could take a big chainsaw and cut through the southwest United States, north to south, you would see these huge cliffs. These are really big cliffs. And then you have the Grand Canyon, which is a mile deep. So you have these huge erosion features. The ocean, those layers used to continue, but they've been eroded away. And the evolutionists say that the layers that we see in the Grand Canyon represent 300 million years. But when you look at the layers themselves, there is virtually no evidence of erosion between the layers. You also see in the rocks that they are often bent. And so here you have a rock layer. You can see that it's a pretty good size layer, and it makes a sharp turn. Or this one. The top one is called the Temple Butte Limestone. The evolutionists say it's 385 million years old. The bottom one is called the Muav Limestone. They date that to be 505 million years. Dr. Andrew Snelling is our geologist. He's done a lot of research in Grand Canyon. And look at how those two layers, they bend the same way. And they're, according to the evolutionists, is 120 million years of missing time and material. That is absurd. 120 million years from the time when the bottom layer was deposited until the top layer was formed, and they follow the same curve, and there's no erosion between the layers. And in the northeast end of the Grand Canyon, you have what's called the Kaibab Upwarp, where the whole mile of different layers are all bent the same way. And they represent 300 million years, but the fault, the earthquake that made the movement supposedly happened 70 million years ago, the rocks would have been rock hard. Now you can bend hard rock under high pressure and temperature, but you metamorphose, you change the structure of the rock. These rocks don't make any changes. And these bends of the rock are all over the world. My friend Sergei Golovin in the Ukraine is showing you some. And a friend of mine does mountaineering and leads tours in the mountains of the Himalayas, and he sent me that photo. And then there's this in a road near Jerusalem, Israel. These are evidence that the rock layers were still soft and wet when the earth moved and made the bends and folds. Another evidence that these layers were deposited rapidly is what are called polystrate fossils. They're usually trees. They go through more than one layer of rock. And in this case, this one's going at an angle. Have you ever seen a tree in the forest with nothing holding it up at an angle and it's dead? Have you ever seen a tree like that for a long period of time? No, it's going to rot. It's going to fall to the ground. If that was slowly buried over thousands of years, you wouldn't have that. It would be disintegrated. Here's another one. The bottom of the tree is in a coal deposit, then it goes up through a limestone layer, and then it goes into another coal deposit. Evolutionists say coal is formed in the swamp slowly over hundreds and thousands of years. Can't be true. That had to have been buried rapidly, and the coal has to be the result of a catastrophic process. What about carbon dating and other dating methods? Well, carbon dating is never used to date rocks. So don't let anybody tell you that it is. They use other methods, uranium decaying into lead, potassium into argon. They have very slow decay rates. But those are not telling us the true age of the rocks. This is one example. Mount St. Helens here in eastern Washington erupted in 1980, blew off a third of the mountaintop. In the crater, lava oozed, and eventually the volcano calmed down, and Dr. Steve Austin from the Institute for Creation Research went up, got samples of the lava dome, sent them off to a radiometric dating laboratory. He did not tell them where he got the rocks. He just said, they're recent. They did four different methods on those rocks, and the results came back. These rocks are 340,000 to 2.8 million years old. Well, what are the dating methods supposed to be telling us? They're supposed to be telling us when the lava came out of the ground and hardened into rock. But we know when that happened. Those rocks were all less than 12 years old. So the dating methods were wrong by just a little bit. And this is not uncommon. When we take rocks of known age where we saw the volcano erupt, some human being saw it and reported it, When they apply the dating methods to those rocks, they don't work. But the evolutionists want us to take those methods and apply them to rocks of unknown age where there was no human eyewitness to see the lava come out of the ground and harden, like we've seen recently in Hawaii. And they want us to assume that the dating methods work. But if they don't work on the rocks we do know the age of, we shouldn't trust them on the rocks we don't. The idea that the rock layers of the earth represent hundreds of millions of years is false. It's a lie. And virtually the whole world has been brainwashed with a lie. Most of those rock layers are the result of Noah's flood. Some at the bottom generally don't have any fossils at all, or maybe just microscopic creatures are pre-flood deposits. Some at the top, usually very localized, are post-flood deposits. And so there really is no evidence for millions of years. Noah's flood washes it away. And there's only two places to put the millions of years. It's either before Adam, to put the rock record of rock layers and fossils. It's either before Adam or after Adam. If it's before Adam, we're going to have to say that all that death and disease and suffering was very good, because God called the creation very good before Adam sinned. But what kind of a God would call all of that death and suffering very good? If it was after Adam sinned, the most logical cause of most of it is Noah's flood. So if we accept the millions of years, we're going to have to reject Noah's flood. But if we believe what God says about the flood, then we must reject the millions of years. And Paul says in Romans that even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools. The reason people don't see the evidence is abundant. The reason they don't see it is because they're suppressing the truth in unrighteousness. So every Christian needs to decide what their authority is for determining truth. Is it the infallible word of God? Or is it the fallible opinions of sinful men? So I want to encourage you to think about these issues and to realize that virtually the whole world has been fed a lie that our existence is the result of a big accident, an explosion called the Big Bang. And there's no purpose or meaning to life. There's no right or wrong. You can just do whatever you want. It's all a lie. And it's also a lie that there is no God that we have to answer to someday. So I encourage you to think about these things.